Everyone, welcome to Attack of the Show, South Park versus Islam. Let's get into it. Last night, did Comedy Central lay down the censorship law, or did Matt and Trey pull one over on us? We've got some theories. Plus, close your eyes and imagine your dream car. Got it? Yeah, well, it sucks compared to what was just unveiled at the New York Auto Show. And we've got the beauty shots for you. And a movie about female gymnasts. Yeah, I'm sold. We've got the star and the director of Stick It here to treat me like a pommel horse. Hot. All this plus movie talk with Chud.com creator Nick Nunziata, comic book reviews and fresh ink, and a live performance by musical guests Hawk Nelson. Get ready, folks, for the television equivalent of a wet willy. It's Attack of the Show.
Pick up on this.
All right, we'll take it, we'll take it. Just kind of want to put that energy into a little Capri Sun pouch and pierce it with a straw and just suck it up. Isn't that great? Hey, everybody, welcome to the show. It's Thursday, April 13th. Happy Passover, kids. I'm Kevin Pereira.
And I'm Olivia Munn. But you might have guessed that up by now, huh?
Yeah, I think we put it at the bottom of the screen. It's what we do in television.
We're on TV?
Yeah, we are. Speaking of which, the old television last week, did you see South Park by any chance?
Season pass on my TiVo, Kev.
I forgot you're a season pass kind of girl. All right. Well, last night's episode was amazing. One of my favorite. Matt Stone and Trey Parker threw even more gasoline on the fire in their ongoing feud with Comedy Central censors. Yeah. The episode was the second part of the Cartoon War saga where Cartman travels to Los Angeles to try to get Family Guy canceled for airing an image of Muhammad. Now, Kyle shows up, he foils Cartman's scheme, and Fox airs the animated prophet. Free speech prevails, yeah! At least in the cartoon world. Unfortunately, here in the real world, Comedy Central refused to air the potentially blasphemous image. Who'd have thunk? Well, to be completely honest, we're not sure whether Comedy Central actually censored this part of the show or if the censorship scenes were just written into the script as a gag. It's something that Matt and Trey would probably try to pull over on us. Either way, terrorists see the episode of Family Guy and they immediately retaliate with some of the best television I've seen in a long time. Take a look.
Look at me, I'm Jesus. Who would you like me to crap on you, Mr. Bush? Yummy crap.
Yeah, hey, you know, Comedy Central wouldn't show Muhammad giving a football helmet to Peter Griffin, but I guess they're totally cool with Jesus crapping on the American flag, which goes to show, my friends, that South Park is really one of those rare shows that can actually make serious social commentary while still being disturbingly funny. In fact, last night one character even said, at least Family Guy doesn't get all up its ass with messages. Ugh, that's why they're getting a Peabody, people. God bless them.
All right. You know, actually, I didn't catch that one last night, Kev.
No?
It's on my TiVo. I'm going to watch it.
Okay.
I was actually really engrossed in American Idol.
I can't blame you.
Yeah, it was another jam-packed results show. Just when you think things couldn't get any cheesier, the eight finalists kicked things off with a rockin' medley of Queen songs.
Yeah. It's funny you mentioned that. I actually wore my official Freddie Mercury hot pants in celebration.
Shut up!
Yeah?
I have two pair.
What color?
Red and purple.
Oh, hot pink leopard print. Yeah.
All right, let's just wipe that mental image right off.
Sorry.
Yeah, thanks. After the medley, though, the contestants watched heartfelt video messages from their families and had a good old cry. But the warm and fuzzy stuff just didn't last long because America voted and Bucky got the boot. It was about time.
Yeah, it was. It was.
I totally
agree. Bucky needed to go, but not before Ace. I mean, come on. Seriously, let's be honest with each other. Captain Falsetto, he needs the big boot. Sure, don't get me wrong. Bucky belongs behind the counter at a Waffle House. I get that. But how many more weeks are we going to have to passively stand by while Ace hooks his cute little thumbs into his giant scorpion belt buckle and talks about the importance of his colored beanies while flashing bedroom eyes at the camera? Enough! Get him out of there!
Hey, now, I'm actually a fan of Ace's voice. I could do without the come hither looks, but, you know, he's got my vote. But I guess as, you know, long as we're waiting, we're just going to have to find out what America thinks.
Yes, next week, we'll see. All right, we've got to man things up here. Enough of this crap. The New York Auto Show rumbles into the Big Apple tomorrow. And there's more than enough production cars, concept cars, and fuel-efficient hybrids to jumpstart anyone's drool sensors. Like, say, the Celine Parnelli Jones Limited Edition Mustang. It's got 370 horsepower and a V8, so it's ideal for guys with small or felons that are trying to elude the cops, either way.
You're going to get two, right?
I'm leasing, yes. Yes. The 2007 Saturn Aura will be available as a hybrid, so tree huggers can finally look cool. And for all you outdoorsy types, Jeep has unveiled a 2007 Wrangler Unlimited that features four doors instead of the standard deuce. So now you can bring more friends along when you go off-roading or drug smuggling through rough terrain. Either way, win-win, Olivia. The New York Auto Show runs from April 14th through the 23rd. It's definitely worth checking out. Everybody in the area should go or fly, either way.
Definitely. I love car shows.
Do you?
I love car shows.
See, I didn't know that about you. In fact, I bet our viewers didn't know that. And that's why we're taking your questions about Olivia today. So fans and recreational stalkers, feel free to email us through our web form, attackoftheshow.com/askus. Or you can chat with us in our little chat room at chat.g4tv.com. You're good.
Good. Thanks. All right, coming up after this, Chud.com's Nick Nunziata is going to talk about his first foray into film production, and he's got the scoop on which pair of superhero tights Adam Sandler might be squeezing into.
Hot.
Welcome. I'm Dr. Jay Hopkins of the Dorkma Initiative, and this is another Lost Viewer Orientation. Today, I've brought on an expert in an effort to speed up our analysis of last night's episode. Henry, if you're ready, we'll begin. With episode 207, SOS, it focused heavily on the characters of Bernard and Rose. First incident, the SOS signal. Bernard encourages his fellow castaways to build a giant distress signal out of black rocks on the beach.
Black rocks.
The castaways abandon the project, and Bernard is only able to half-finish the S in SOS. Seen from above, the rocks form a frowning face staring out at the ocean.
It's meaningless. God, you fool! It means nothing!
Incident 2, Locke's poem. Locke is shown attempting to recreate the mysterious map which we saw on the hatch wall 2 weeks ago.
Oh, right, the map. I mean, that's the answer to everything, right?
Is it?
Maybe.
Locke is using a page from a French poetry book as scrap paper. The poem is an 18th century work by Alfred de Musset. One of the lines is translated as, "The lilies in the spring will always be in flowers, and the immortal arts will rejuvenate continually." This obviously proves that the island has healing powers, hence why Locke no longer needs a wheelchair, and Rose is no longer dying of cancer. Furthermore, the mention of the magnetic fields...
Understand a thing, do you? I mean, the symbols... It's all in your head. It's a TV show.
Do you see what that is? That is a film camera. We are shooting on film, and it is expensive. If you're not going to cooperate, I'm going to have Leo get the hose again.
We're rolling.
Ugh, this is the worst idea we've ever had in this lab. Incident 5. Neil Frogert. This mysterious survivor is mentioned as one of the volunteers Bernard recruits to help with the distress signal. His name is a reference to the classic Treehouse of Horror episode on The Simpsons, in which Homer buys a Krusty the Clown doll from a forbidden object dealer, who also sells frozen yogurt. The doll Homer buys is cursed and tries to kill his family. You'll recall that Kate picks up a doll in the jungle and springs a booby trap.
Simpsons? Are you serious? Has it come to this?
That's it! That's it! I've had enough! This is getting nowhere! Leo, get the cage ready!
Chud.com or Cinematic Happenings Under Development.com is one of the premier movie news and rumor sites on the web, but now its creator Nick Nunziata is making the jump from fan to filmmaker. Quite a leap, Nick.
I should be destroyed for it.
You should, and you probably will,
yeah,
by your own message board following.
That's the truth.
Before we get into that, I have to say, failure to launch, mm-hmm. Basic Instinct 2, instant classics, but What about the rest of the films this year? Where's all the good stuff?
You know, it's a weird thing. It's almost like now you have to find out who the good creators are and kind of just latch on to them, follow them around. Like, the people you know are going to deliver a good movie.
The Brett Ratners of the world,
oh, my goodness.
Sorry.
I guess,
I shouldn't have gone there.
There are people in hospitals that really enjoy it.
Yes.
But honestly, I mean, there are some good stuff. Thank You for Smoking is a good movie. There's a movie with Jeff Bridges called The Amateurs about a town that makes a porn film together. Oh. You can't go wrong with that.
Can't go wrong with that.
And then there's those ones that sneak up on us. I mean, like, nobody knew The Matrix was going to be great when it came out. Nobody knew that Showgirls was going to be... Never mind.
Right. Yeah. Well, it was phenomenal.
It was.
In short bursts.
Yeah,
which is really how you digest a film like Showgirls.
Well, and that's usually how people critique it, with short bursts across the room.
Now, so there are good movies. You just have to be on the lookout for them. We should be satisfied that we've seen one or two this year so far, perhaps?
Yeah, I mean, and last year was kind of a lame year anyway. But I think if you, it's just like anything else, music or whatever. You find those people that you like, and you always can rely on them.
Right.
And if anything else, you know, happens, it's a bonus. But you know what? Sometimes it's good to see bad movies too. It's, you know, it's fun to go out and ridicule them.
We still have the Showgirls on DVD. It's fine. We're set for the next 15,
20
years.
It comes with a deck of cards. So.
Love it. You started Chud.com to really kind of talk about films and rip apart bad ones,
yeah,
et cetera. But now you're involved with producing one, right?
Yeah. So I'm a hypocrite, basically.
Good
yeah.
for you. No,
yeah.
I mean, have you taken your own warnings and heeded your own advice?
I have. I've actually tried to be like the better man, and it hasn't stuck, really. But it's fun. You know, it's kind of, you know.
The movie Meg. Tell me about this film that you're involved
in. Okay, it's about this giant shark, a prehistoric shark that is actually still alive, and it stars in Sleepless in Seattle. No, it's like a 90-foot shark that's like, you know, the megalodon is a real shark from back in the day.
Okay.
And it's, you know, it terrorizes the countryside, and it's just a big giant adventure film. We got the guy that directed Twister and Speed doing it.
Very
and
nice.
it's just too cool. But it's not exactly the Oscar type film, so I could kind of, you know, ease my way and take the wounds as they come.
Well, and you brought us an exclusive image from the film, right?
I did.
Okay,
so
what are we going to see here?
Okay, well, it's a shark.
Okay,
and
prehistoric shark.
A prehistoric shark.
Okay.
I don't know if he's still prehistoric because he's around now, but he's a prehistoric shark, you know, back in the day. And he's huge, and he likes the taste of man flesh.
Let's see the image. I
want to
see it here.
Yeah.
This is a world exclusive. Boom!
Look at that. That's incredible.
Now, is that a Photoshop, or is this something, did you build a giant prop and then have Vern Troyer like do like the dorsal fin? Like that?
Yeah, no, it's unfortunately it's fake, but it would be great if it was real because I would take up surfing. You know,
just to go alongside.
No, that's like one of the signature money shots from the film. The other money shots are more like Showgirls money shots.
Gotcha. Well, you got to have them in there.
That's the truth. Yeah.
So now, again, going from the outside of the industry to the inside now, how's the experience been? Has it been everything it's supposed to be cracked up to be, or?
Honestly, well, I'm still kind of a green rookie in this whole thing, and I'm certainly not the leading producer on this thing.
Mm-hmm.
What I've discovered is that I knew nothing about movies. You know, and honestly, if I knew everything that I know today, if I knew it 10 years ago, I doubt I would have started Chud, and I doubt I would have been such a rabid guy.
Right.
But it's great now because now you get hardened and you learn the ropes, you learn what to do and what not to do, and it's been great. And actually, I kind of rediscovered my love for movies through it.
Oh, cool. That's good.
And I've taken a beating and a half.
But you're still doing the Chud thing, which is great. You haven't quit the day job yet.
No, and I've got a great staff.
And what about rumors? Because that's what you guys break. Do you have anything exclusive here you can touch
on?
Yeah,
I've got a rumor coupled with speculation.
Oh, we thrive on that right
Okay.
Here.
There's a shark movie coming out. No, okay. The guy that directed a bunch of Adam Sandler films has agreed to do Shazam. You know, the superhero guy, the guy with the lightning bolt.
Oh, you're talking about the Genie Shaquille O'Neal movie.
No, that's a classic, though.
Yeah, that is a good one.
And Steel is not to be, you know, forgotten as well. It's that guy, Peter Seagal, it's not Peter Seagal because then he'd be running funny. it's him, and he's doing Shazam, and his known accomplice is Adam Sandler.
Ah.
So you put two and two together, and the possibility of Adam Sandler putting on the tights of Shazam.
Sounds good.
It sounds like the thorn in the side, or probably the final nail in the movie coffin for comic books.
It'll pave the way for you, at least, to release a superhero shark.
I want to do like the ambush bug movie, like the most obscure character I could find and really, really run rampant.
Actually, Marvel's going to be doing that in a couple of years. They're just churning through them at this point.
They're insane.
What about this weekend? What should we see? What's out there? Anything worth actually going to the theaters for?
I'd say probably the best movie featuring a child molester this weekend is hard candy.
Gotcha.
So I mean, you can't
not the YouTube video that I put on my MySpace profile, right?
No, I mean like if you need to see a movie with child molestation, hard candy is the one to see. This
have
week.
To. No, but, I mean, I heard this movie is going to be phenomenal.
And yeah, no, it's not what you think. It's not the kind of movie you think it would be. It turns things on its ear, and I have to admit, it has possibly the best movie poster I've seen in a couple of years. The little Red Riding Hood in the bear trap. That's incredible. Great stuff.
All right. So your recommendation this weekend, Hard Candy.
Hard Candy.
Followed up with Showgirls. And then stick around because next year we're going to see Meg.
Yeah. Which is the God willing.
Jaws with a money shot.
Oh, yeah. Jaws was a snack.
Is that the tagline?
No, because they don't pay me for that kind of stuff for sure.
Nick, thanks for coming on, man.
Pleasure.
Appreciate it. Best of luck with the film,
thanks.
Everybody. For movie news and updates on Nick's production, visit Chud.com. Now still ahead. We're going to take you behind the scenes of the breakthrough interactive series Star Trek 2.0+. If it's Thursday, then comic book expert Blair Butler must be here with her fresh ink reviews. And yeah, well, she is, because it's Thursday. Wednesday, new comic books hit the shelves, and every Thursday, comic expert Blair Butler gives us her report. It's fresh ink. I have been on pins and needles, walking on, imagine eggshells sprinkled over a minefield. That has been me waiting for my comic book fix.
It's a beautiful visual, Kevin.
Thank you for that.
It's very nice.
It ended with me exploding and losing a leg and screaming on the ground.
It happens.
All right, what do we have this week, Blair?
All right, we begin with Young Avengers, Volume 1, Ooh. Sidekicks. It's a graphic novel. That means they collected together like the first seven or eight issues of this comic into one sleek and beautifully illustrated volume.
Amazing artwork on
yes.
this one.
Yes. Okay, traditionally, teen superheroes suck. This time, actually kind of enjoyable. What's great about this comic, great characters. The art is fantastic, really gorgeous, and it's hilarious. It's really funny. Like, these guys are, they're sort of bumbling, they're screwing up their attempts to save people. There's just a lot of funny dialogue and stuff. The one thing that didn't work for me is it sort of felt like they were forcing some soap opera-ish hookups in there, just to have a little teen steam. And I have to say, with that one minor reservation about the hookups, Young Avengers Volume 1 is a buy.
Wow.
Yeah.
Kicking it off with a buy. That's not bad.
Yeah.
All right. I'm going to just go out on a limb and predict that this is going to be a great week for comics.
I think it might be.
Let's see. Let's move it on. Star Wars Rebellion.
Right.
I'm sick and tired of Star Wars, so please tell me this is going to, reinvigorate me.
It's not going to reinvigorate you, but for comic book fans who say you like Star Wars, but you've only seen the movies once, you're not crazy, you're not stand in line for 10 hours. This is a good comic book first issue that people who aren't super familiar with Star Wars can pick up and enjoy. It's not all inside jokes. It's an interesting concept. It takes place right after the first movie, first or second movie, somewhere in there. And it's basically, it's a guy that grew up with Luke Skywalker, except now he works for the evil empire.
Oh.
And he's trying to bring down the rebellion. And the nice thing about it is it sort of points out, even the bad guys think they're good guys. They do.
And Vin Diesel makes a cameo in this
one,
right?
There's a guy that does kind of look like Vin Diesel in it. But you know what I liked about this was really, it's sort of from the Empire's point of view, and they don't think they're so bad. There's a really great Garth Ennis story in Star Wars Tales that was about a stormtrooper, and this guy's a little bit above that. So I say it's a buy if you're a Star Wars fan, even if you're just a casual Star Wars fan.
All right, Star Wars Rebellion, Young Avengers, both buys.
Yep.
Good week. So
yes.
Far, we have one left.
One left.
Let's talk about Black Orchid. This thing is, I even know about this comic, and
yeah.
I shouldn't. Like, it's
right.
Ridiculously popular.
First was published in 1988. Why do we care? Well, it's by Neil Gaiman and Dave McKeon, who are two of the masters who sort of reinvented comics and made comics what they are today. It's a DC character from the 70s called the Black Orchid. She was a superhero, and she would disguise herself and infiltrate these gangs and, mobsters and stuff and bring down criminal organizations. This one starts with the black orchid getting killed in an incredibly grim, grisly manner. And, you know, back when this came out in 88, that was kind of shocking to people. Batman's in it, Lex Luthor, I mean,
hot,
tons of characters.
Hot, naked, purple women everywhere.
Right? Lots of hot, naked, purple flower women. Anyway, it's really two masters of the genre. Neil Gaiman, who went on to do Sandman, and Dave McKeon, who went on to do stuff like Arkham Asylum, and then together they made the movie Mirror Mask. I really recommend it to people who are kind of curious about how we sort of got where we are today with comics. I think it's great, and it's sort of overlooked. Watchmen and Dark Knight are always talking about.
So what's your verdict then? Because you have to. It's a formality.
Right.
What's your verdict for Black Orchid?
Black Orchid graphic novel. It's a buy, definitely.
Done. Yep. Blair, as always, thank you so much for coming by.
Thank you, Kevin.
Don't you go changing or moving, because I've got today's news just the way you like it in the feed. Plus, the new series Star Trek 2.0 puts fans behind the wheel of the USS Enterprise, and we'll show you how they do it. But first, Attack of the Show once played a little practical joke on its fans with a fake website called Geek Fantasies. Let's take a fond look back.
This equation has been satisfied.
Hey, welcome back to Attack of the Show. We're live. So you watch your mouth, Mom. Still on the way, we've got a live performance by musical guests Hawk Nelson, and the director and star of the gymnastics movie Stick It will help me work on my dismount from the couch. But while I stretch on out, you enjoy today's top news stories. Olivia, why don't you take it away?
In music news, the Billboard Top 200 album chart has been released, and it's an eclectic list. Tim McGraw anchors the top five with his Greatest Hits Volume 2 Reflected, while the High School Musical soundtrack comes in fourth. T.I.'s King comes in third. The compilation album Now That's What I Call Music Volume 21 is number two. And Rascal Flatts take the top spot with Me and My Gang. In other music news, the Beatles finally will dip a timid toe into the online music pool. The Fab Four's label, Apple Core, confirmed that it is digitally remastering its entire catalog. This would pave the way for eventually selling the songs online. Over in movie news, the historical romance The New World, starring Colin Farrell, is getting an interesting new twist for its Japanese premiere. Thanks to new smell-o-vision technology developed in Japan, moviegoers will sniff special scents meant to suggest anger, joy, and sadness in sync with selected scenes. Well, you won't need any fancy technology to smell DOA when it eventually arrives in theaters. New stills from the movie adaptation of the popular video game have just surfaced. Despite, or maybe because of, the involvement of Transporter director Corey Yuen, this babe-sploitation flick destined for the so bad it's great category. In other news, what's really in a name? In the case of one Utah school, some embarrassment and a few hundred bucks in expenses. Ogden, Utah's Da Vinci Academy scored a real coup in getting Daily Show anchor Jon Stewart to headline its annual fundraising gala. Or so they thought. They had, in fact, booked another Jon Stewart, this one a retired motivational speaker and part-time professional wrestler. The school canceled Mr. Stewart's appearance when a reporter pointed out the mistake. And in office supply news, what can you get for one red paperclip? Kyle McDonald was just offered a year's free rent in Phoenix. Since going online last year, McDonald has traded his red paperclip for a fish pen, which he then swapped for a doorknob, and so on and so on. The free furnished apartment is the latest transaction in McDonald's quest to own his own home. And finally, a Tennessee elementary school teacher faces some grown-up detention for using MySpace. Pamela Rogers pleaded guilty last year to sexual battery and the statutory rape of a 13-year-old student. As part of the plea deal, Rogers was ordered not to communicate with the victim or his family and not to use the internet. Police allege she has since done both, blogging on her MySpace page about apparent communications she has had with the victim's sister. That's the feed, news hounds. For more information, check out g4tv.com/thefeed.
Guess what, Star Trek fans? Space is no longer the final frontier. That's right. G4's new series, Star Trek 2.0, takes the classic adventures of Kirk and Spock into the mysterious realm of interactive media. Here to wax Klingon is one of the masterminds behind Star Trek 2.0, Glenn Cole. Glenn, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much.
So now you guys came up with Star Trek 2.0. I've heard all about it. I've seen some of the buzz that's been created online. What is Star Trek 2.0 exactly?
It's a fun new way to interact with an old classic. You get trivia while you watch, stats, there's a real-time chat, and then there's a play while you watch game called the Spock Market.
Okay, so let me paint the picture. I'm at home. I'm in the boxer briefs. Nothing else.
That's
kind of Haagen-Dazs. Got the laptop open. Star Trek's on the TV, but what's on my computer monitor? What am I seeing there?
You've got the Spock Market website right there, and you're trying to manage your portfolio of stocks, which are based on characters from the show, aliens, ships, things like that. You're watching the show to see what things are driving that value of those stocks up or down, make savvy trades, being in your boxers.
Interesting. Yeah, so on that, well, that's what day traders do, okay? It's casual, bunny slippers and boxers. On the TV, though, we've got the show, we've got info that's popping up in real time. There's also the ticker from the Spock Market, correct?
Yeah, that's right.
So all sorts of media coming at us in all sorts of ways. And what is the Spock Market exactly, though? It sounds like kind of like fantasy baseball.
Yeah, it's like day trading meets fantasy baseball. So you've got the goal to win, you want to build the best portfolio,
sure.
And as stocks go up and you want to sell them, as they go down, you want to buy them. So that's the objective.
But this isn't like shares of gold and Google stock. This is all related to Star Trek, right?
Yeah, that's right. So you might have, you might want to invest heavily in Kirk, but then you'll find out later that might be a bad bet, depending what the episode is.
So Barry Bonds has a steroid scandal. His stock goes down in a fantasy scenario. Kirk in Turnabout Intruder, he gets taken over by a woman. His stock perhaps splits. Who knows, right? It's going to affect the market.
You'll have to play to see whether that drives the stock up or down. But another example would be in an early episode, there's a female crewman. She walks onto the bridge. Suddenly, there's a stock on the ticker that starts dropping. It's called FCU. It's Federation Costume and Uniform. That's because she's wearing an old school uniform that gets updated later in the series. You got to track these things. That's how you learn
that.
The rules.
So it's not just as straightforward. It's not like bland. It's only about Kirk and only about Spock. Like there's other stocks going on at all times. So
yeah, and there's some obscure ones. And then there's like the icons,
sure.
the Spocks.
Now what I don't think I'm not the biggest Star Trek fan in the world in the sense that I don't know every line on every episode. I can't tell you how many steps Captain Kirk takes between the bathroom and the bridge.
Right.
Some people can, though. Do I stand a snowball's chance competing against these kind of guys in Star Trek 2.0?
Yeah, that's because you can know what's going to happen in this episode, but you don't know if Kirk kicking ass is going to make his stock go up or it's going to make it go down. It depends on how he's kind of handling the situation or if he's in a romantic interlude or talking like this.
Right.
That might
I love it. I love it, man. This is clearly the future of TV. It's like it's a mashup on my monitor and on my television. I really appreciate it.
Cool. That was the inspiration for his music mashups, actually.
I think it's going to be a huge hit, Glenn. Thanks
cool.
for coming on and
Thanks
talking
very much.
About it.
All right.
Everybody, Star Trek 2.0 airs weeknights at 11 p.m. only here on the G4. So to get fully immersed, go to g4tv.com/Trek 2.0. It's going to be a lot of fun. I'm going to trade. I'll beat you. Don't worry, I have insider info. When we come back, musical guests Hawk Nelson rock you sweetly into the weekend. Plus, the director and the star of the new movie Stick It are going to plant themselves on our couch. You don't want to miss it. Stay tuned.
The Feed is brought to you by the U.S. Navy. Navy, accelerate your life.
Now, what do you get when you mix beautiful gymnasts, spandex, and pommel horses? I mean, besides every dream that I've had since sophomore year, you get the new movie, Stick It.
Mina, right?
Yeah, Mina.
Mina, put down the phone.
Can you tell Joanne that I'm going to take over and do a real dismount?
Joanne Haley's on the phone. She's going to do a real dismount.
I heard her. Thank you.
How about a double back?
You will not throw a double back without training it first, Haley.
Close your eyes.
Over my dead body.
A little CPR might do you good.
Haley!
She's crazy.
Ouch. Joining me is the director and writer of Stick It, Jessica Bendinger, and the star of the movie, Missy Peregrim. Ladies, thank you for joining us.
Thank you. Thanks for having us.
Jessica, you wrote Bring It On.
Yes.
Movie about cheerleaders.
Guilty.
As charged, right?
Yes.
This time you decided to focus on an actual sport, which I think is interesting.
Yeah.
I was waiting for you to reach across and punch me. That's good. Good way to keep it under
wraps. I was looking for a way to get less clothing into a movie. Actually, I went from shorts to leotards. Yeah. That was really the real motivation.
Thank you for that. You got my notes then, I see.
Yes,
on your first
I did.
Film. No, what inspired you to do gymnastics exactly?
Well, I think gymnastics is a really undervalued and badass sport. I think it's, you know, the things that they do with their bodies are incredible, and it's really visually interesting, and I thought it would be fun to try and make a comedy that was also like an action movie for kids.
Sure, and the premise is Missy here is a bad girl, sentenced to gym class? Or?
She basically is a bad girl whose father kind of gets a judge to send her back to the gym to shape up her act, and it doesn't work.
It shaped up a lot more than her act, and that's, Missy, I hope you don't mind me saying, you have a 24-pack in this film. Like, it's ridiculous, and try as they might, I've tried the shake for breakfast, the shake for lunch, sometimes a sensible dinner.
The trick is the makeup. I painted lines.
Is that what it is?
Right,
it's entirely airbrushed?
Yeah. All, yeah.
I tried tanning with a cardboard cutout of abs once. It just didn't work. It didn't work at all.
That's a lot of sun.
Now, I mean, how much training did you do for this thing?
Not very much. I was like pretty much already in shape already.
But what about?
Totally, I'm totally lying.
No, okay. Really?
No, we trained for 4 months.
Really?
She trained for 4 months. Yeah.
She was just like, you know, can you really try that again? And they really, you know, can we add another 3 million hours on their 6 hour day
it
already?
It was 6 hours a day for 4 months.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's pretty intensive. I mean, when I used to compete, I'd get a sprained wrist or an ankle. Sometimes I'd pull a hammy. Mom would have to massage it with goat's milk. But this is a pretty serious sport. I mean, like, this is definitely physical activity, right? Did you ever hurt yourself or?
Yeah, gymnastics is full of hurts and pains. I mean, I thought it was going to be pretty easy. You know, I grew up playing sports. So I was like, yeah,
sure.
I'll do this.
You were a big soccer
you know?
Player, right?
Yeah, soccer and basketball, whatever, you know. And gymnastics is not really a normal sport by any means. You are hurt every day you go into the gym.
Now, did you retain any of the skills that you learned through training? Do you
do
a back handspring when you get through the door or anything like that? Or?
No party tricks. Not really, anyway. Just these abs.
God bless you. I'm rocking the pony keg, so you make me jealous. All right, Jessica, I have to ask, your heart, how cold and black is it? And I ask this because, for two reasons. One,
can I answer that?
Please do, no. Two reasons, actually, Jessica. One, because every 15 to perhaps 30-year-old male is going to be dragged to this film by their girlfriend. And two, once they go and actually enjoy it, I did with Bring It On, I gotta be honest, they can't admit how much they actually loved it, even though they quote it to their friends when they're watching Ultimate Fighting.
Yeah.
At least, I mean, I certainly don't. The guy I know has done something like that. Do you sit there and cackle while you're writing these scripts because you know you're putting us in awkward positions?
Yeah, I do. And by the way, I have to say, I'm very proud of the fact that this tested really high with guys. I thought they'd be too embarrassed to write excellent and very good on those cards, but apparently not.
Was it the midriff that we're seeing here, or was it the short shorts?
I think it's the ice bath. I think there might be some temperature changes in some of the shots where things happen. I don't want to get into it.
Oh, wait, I want Missy to get into it, though. What's the temperature change ice bath?
It was an accident. It was not intentional.
There was some intentional cold-heartedness on the set, though, Missy. Something, you pulled a prank on someone. What's the deal here?
Well, being in the position that we were in every day training for 4 months and then going on set, and it was just the craziest days and a lot of pressure to really make things the best way possible in a long hour day, whatever.
Sure.
So we had, it was just time to get Jessica back for everything she'd put us through. She knew exactly what she was doing when she said we had to train.
Right.
And so me and the makeup artist, Whitney James, we decided to pretend that I had kind of done my own surgery and had an ingrown hair.
On my bikini line. Yeah. Shooting
but
the scene sequence. It was huge. It was the size of a quarter. Open wound.
Yeah.
Looked like she had septic shock from the wound.
Did it wink at you when she walked out?
Pretty much.
Had that been real, you would have had to cancel the shoot for the day, right?
Yeah, I'm calling the exec producer. We're going, insurance day, what are we going to do? Trying to keep it together so she doesn't feel bad for mauling herself. And then they fall on the floor laughing because clearly I'm a dork and completely fell for it.
Well done.
Yeah.
Well done. Well, I got to tell you, the trailer alone tested very high with me. There were definitely temperature changes. And I wish you both the best
of
luck with it.
Awesome.
Thank you so much.
Everybody, look for Stick It April 28th in theaters everywhere. And you can check out the movie's official website, stickitmovie.com. Also, this is very important. Drop by their MySpace profile at myspace.com/stickitmovie. I will be in their top 8. I guarantee it.
Absolutely.
Coming up, everybody, musical guest Hawk Nelson put our studio microphones through their paces. Stick around. But first, let's take another look at that fake website we once created to titillate and amuse the fanboys. It's something we called Geek Fantasies.
Welcome back to the show. Now I hope you're adequately prepared to rock. Please welcome Hawk Nelson. Be sure to check out Hawk Nelson's smile. It's the end of the world on shelves right now, and visit attackoftheshow.com for more information. All right, everyone, stay where you are. We'll be getting your emails and chat questions right after the break. But first, let's take one last visit to Geek Fantasies, our favorite fake fetish site.
Your magic missile has been resisted.
iPod of the stars.
Bucky Covington's iPod. I lost the Carter sisters and Mother Maybelle with Chet Atkins. Bad haircut, Supernova. I'm a loser, the Beatles. No talent, Tip Irie. I'm pathetic, Sean Love.
All right, before we get to our little IRC chat questions, there's actually some breaking news from the Sony Pictures lot here in Hollywood. According to Defamer.com, Sony employees are being terrorized by a swarm of killer bees. And I'm serious, I'm not kidding. Workers are actually trapped in buildings. Firefighters are really confused. And if I know Hollywood, a script is already being written as I speak. So just wanted to give you a little update. It's kind of funny. Bees in a Building, starring Sam Jackson. No. Okay, let's go to the chat room. How about that? Matt Splatt, Olivia, if you were lost on an island, how would you try to get off?
Ah, interesting. I, quick thinking, I would find lots of rocks, and I would tear down trees, and I would build a raft, and I would use the palm leaves to make a sail, and I would wait for a windy day.
Wow. Okay. Yeah. You've thought this through, apparently. Like, that's quite thorough.
All the time, actually.
All right. Babe Magnet wants to know, if Olivia was forced into cannibalism, who would she eat first? I love these questions.
Yeah. I don't know who exactly, but maybe someone like Star Jones, like who likes to eat good food, so they'll taste good.
Mm. And lots of it, apparently.
Yeah.
But didn't she have the stomach thing?
From what I know, which is sad that I know this, she doesn't talk about it.
Oh.
Yeah, it's a little
hush-hush. The mutation which we don't speak of. Okay, no. All right. Sammy Ray says, what is Olivia's favorite part of her Japanese heritage?
I'm actually not Japanese. My mom.
Way to go, douche.
Yeah, my mom.
God.
My mom, who actually was so happy that I even mentioned her yesterday, she...
Hi, Mom. Go ahead.
She loves you, by the way.
I know. Mom loves
you. She's like, you tell Kev, I think he's so funny. You know, he talks so good. He talks.
Awesome.
I like him. But she remarried a man in the military, and we lived in Tokyo, Air Force.
All right.
Not that great.
And We Totted asks, Olivia, do you have any tats? Are you inked?
I have no tattoos.
No?
No.
Really? Any particular reason, or...?
No, it's permanent. It's forever.
Yeah, I gotcha.
It's like, you know, I don't know.
All right, we'll take one more, then we'll get to some rock. Moment of Ben says, Olivia, is it the car that makes the man or the man that makes the car?
You know, my little brother is an awesome, awesome guy, and he has...
Where are you going with this one? I mean, does he drive a Jetta? I don't get what you're... I'm sorry, continue. Don't let me...
You went too far, Kev.
I knocked the train off the
rails. He's got a great car, but he's a great guy, and I think that it's the guy that makes the car, because he's both.
Done. Oh, very sweet. Aww. Shout out to Mom and Brother. All right, that is it. Enough with the mushy
All
stuff.
All right. Thanks to our guests, Nick Nunziata, Glenn Cole, Missy Peregrine, Jessica Bettinger, and Blair Butler. And now, one more time, Hawk Nelson.
Yeah!
This song's for everybody who drives a punch buggy.